Okay, good afternoon, everybody. We're going to get started now, so appreciate everybody joining us here. We're going to take about 30 minutes of your time. For starters, if everyone could, how do you do that here?
It will be in the GoToMeeting interface.
Okay, if you can raise your hand.
Yep, there'll be a raise your hand button right in the GoToMeeting interface, just to make sure everybody can hear us and see the screen, and you can kind of see the mouse moving right now, make sure everybody is live. Looks like we're getting positive feedback.
All right, great. So thanks for doing that. We are ready to get going. And my name is Chris Tarka. We'll kind of quickly do some introductions here. I manage our sales team. I've also been a user of SolidWorks for quite some time, about 16 years or so. And then we also have Dan Wagner will be doing the presentation here for you.
Yep.
Also, he manages our tech support team for SolidWorks. And we have Matt Kelly. We refer to him as Mr. Kelly, if you're okay with that, Matt.
I'm okay with that.
So Matt's here. He's been with Prism a long time, and he's our expert on the CAM end of things. So, so with regards to today, the agenda looks, we just went through the intros, but the MasterCAM loyalty program. I want to talk a little bit more about how did we come up with this, why did we come up with this, and we'll get into that. We're going to follow that up quickly with a demonstration, and then we're going to end it with Q&A. And as far as any questions, I'm logged in, Matt's logged in as well, so we'll be able to see your questions pop up on the screen. And we can try to address those as the presentation is occurring, or we could table them until the end. Okay, either way. We'll try to get to all your questions. And then, and that's basically what the next 25 or so minutes are going to look like. It's a great opportunity for us, obviously, to say thank you for your business. I'm assuming that you're an existing customer of ours. You may have SolidWorks. You may have just MasterCAM. This is more geared towards the MasterCAM-only type of user. But either way, we thank you for being here, spending time with us. Thank you for your business. And we'll move on from here, the loyalty program. All right, so why did we come up with this? Essentially, you have two different products here. They are the leaders in their industry. We've got, but they're designed to do two different things. Now, MasterCAM, as we know, it's a primary focus on creating toolpaths. And in doing so, it does have somewhat of a CAD front end in order to get the job done, and it needs those CAD tools, and we understand, and what we've seen in our experience, many customers are using some of those CAD tools as strictly a design product. Ultimately, though, as we know, MasterCAM, its goal is to create toolpaths and cut chips. So, with regards to SolidWorks, it has a primary focus on design and collaboration. So SolidWorks is not going to create toolpaths. We know that. It's never going to produce something that's going to end up sending to a CNC and then cutting chips. It's going to work with programs like MasterCAM. So two inherently different products designed to do two different things, but there is some overlap. Therefore, we have seen this over the years. There's a lot of gaps that can occur with these two products. Today, it's very simple. We have really just one goal to get through today. Does investing in SolidWorks make sense for your business? And we just want to show you throughout the course of a demonstration of what tools are available. They might be filling some significant gaps for you in SolidWorks and how ultimately it can work with the MasterCAM program. And that's all we're trying to answer for today. So whether a SolidWorks investment would make sense in your business. This is a start. Obviously, we can go into demonstrations and have conversations offline specifically to your company. Also, with regards to the price point, we did work with SolidWorks in order to create some incentives for you. So if it does make sense, we want to make the cost of entry as low as we possibly could. Now, with regards to the SolidWorks demonstration, to try to figure out, does this make sense for your business or not, we want to build a foundation, and Dan Wagner is going to do this. He's just going to build a simple part. How do we draw something in SolidWorks? It is different than MasterCAM, although you'll see similarities. After we build that foundation, we're going to simulate an environment where you get a DWG file sent to you. So you have 2D geometry, and we understand, by the way, that you can machine right off 2D data. But we're going to show how do we take some of the tools and turn that into 3D geometry, thereby getting even more information from that file. Once we have a 3D file, we have a program inside and capability inside SolidWorks called SolidWorks Costing. We're going to show you this tool, help you estimate parts. And then again, when you have that 3D model, different than 2D, fixturing. Okay, how do you design these? Where can you get fixtures? How can we create different looks of setups for your part? We're going to accomplish that for you as well within SolidWorks. Here's a big one. We understand that with the data translation with regards to native and universal file formats, there's a lot of you out there, and we're going to get more into this, but you have the need to read in native formats, and we know it costs some extra money within the MasterCam product, things that come with SolidWorks. So we have extensive translators there. We're going to take a look at those for not only native formats, but the universal formats like Parasolid, ASUS, IGIS, STEP. And we're going to take a look at that, what that might mean to your business. When you bring those files in, you need to be able to have some modeling and capabilities. And we're going to show you how SolidWorks addresses some of those areas. Okay, how do you move geometry, maybe add to the geometry that was sent to you? And then ultimately, creating drawings. We know that some customers of yours or partners of yours out there, they'll send you files, and you need to be able to make drawings. They'll send you 3D files, and you, for quoting purposes and collaboration, you need to make very quickly a front, top, right view, isometric, section view, detail view. So we're going to show you how quick and easy that is inside SolidWorks.
To identify features, sometimes they'll send you a solid model, and they won't tell you what the holes are. They just maybe give you a size, but you don't know what the tolerance is. You don't know if it's a tapped hole, a reamed hole. So this last part here is to show you how you can use SolidWorks to communicate to your customer to narrow all that down so you can quote it correctly.
Right. So that's what we're going to basically run through today. I'm going to hand it off to Wags, Dan Wagner, right now. And he's going to take us on a ride with painting a picture of what SolidWorks might be like in your environment.
Going to take you on one heck of a ride here, everybody. Hold on to your seats. We got about a lot of information to cover in the next, we'll call it about 20 minutes. I know we're shooting for a half an hour webinar. We may go slightly over that, but we'll cover as much as possible here. So just double checking. No questions seem to have popped up yet. I'm sure everybody can still hear and see the screen. So if at any time have any problems, just drop a question in the box and we'll go ahead and address that. So Chris mentioned for just kind of an intro here, what does it look like to sketch a basic part, to create a block in SolidWorks? And I know a lot of you guys are probably very familiar with 3D models and maybe even with 3D modeling and you know how you create them. But just to kind of start from the basics here, I'm just going to assume we're just starting from the ground up. So in SolidWorks, you know, I have SolidWorks open. This is SolidWorks 2013. We're just approaching the end of 2013. SolidWorks 2014 is just about to come out. So in SolidWorks, I can just, like any other program, do File, New, and I'll choose a template here. In SolidWorks, we really create three different things, parts, assemblies, and drawings. Assemblies are just groups of parts, and then you have drawings of both parts and assemblies. So we'll just start a blank part. The part opens up. Right away I can see that it's in inches and it's just a blank part. And I'll sketch right on the front plane because although we're a 3D solid modeler, much of our geometry, much of what we do is still based off of a 2D sketch. So if I just pick that front plane and press sketch, now I'm looking normal to or right at that front plane. And I'm just going to tap my S key to get my shortcut bar up here. And we'll just choose one of my favorite commands, a center rectangle. If you've ever sketched a rectangle in AutoCAD and tried to find its center point, that's a lot of fun, right? Doing two lines and finding their intersection and doing all that, we can do that in one simple command here. So with that box just sketched, I can even then dimension it. Maybe we'll lock it down. Maybe this is, you know, 6 by 10. Matt Kelly tells me no line is ever perfect and nothing's ever perfectly 6 by 10, but, you know, just go with me here and assume that this box is 6 by 10. So if we have a 6x10 box and it's completely locked down, I can jump right to Extruded Boss. And Extruded Boss will take that, you know, closed profile and allow me to push or pull it into 3D. I can use this line here. I'm sure there's probably a little bit of a delay due to the internet connection. Or I can even just come over here and type in. I want this to be maybe a 4-inch extrusion, then I'll come straight out. Green check. So with that created, now we have a box right on the screen. And again, I'll keep in mind that the internet connection is probably slowing things down just a little bit. But, you know, we have a nice box right on the screen. That, again, just created from this simple 2D 6x10 sketch. So once you have that box, you know, our initial sketch was right on that front plane. I can even sketch on any flat face. So, you know, we'll pick this top face, for example. If I pick that top face, I can say, let's start a brand new sketch right on that face. I could look normal too, but just to kind of give you guys that 3D feel, we'll stay kind of off to the, you know, almost like an isometric here. And I'll grab a circle, and we'll just drop maybe one, two, and then three circles right on the top face of that part. You can even pick all three and tell SolidWorks to go ahead and make them equal. So no matter now what this one does, the other three will follow. I'm just kind of creating rules into my models here. Features, extruded cut. We'll take all three of those holes at the same time. We can say maybe it's a blind hole so far into the part. Why don't we just do this, though, right away through all, meaning those cuts will go all the way through that part, green check. So now I have three perfect holes. We could do something like a cross-section just to kind of take a look through the part. We can see clearly that we have three through-all holes and it's just a simple block here. That's really what it's like to take a blank part, sketch a block, and put some holes in it. Not a whole lot going on there, but just to give you guys a feel for what that's like to make a brand-new part in SolidWorks. So I'm going to go ahead and close that part. And kind of stepping into a second part here, I'm sure a lot of you guys deal with 2D data. And you're either getting it and trying to make 3D, or you're machining to it, or you're communicating with it. But whatever it might be, we have a great tool called DraftSight. And DraftSight is a free tool directly from SolidWorks that will open up and deal with 2D data. DraftSight, again, you can get it right from SolidWorks.com. It's basically like an AutoCAD-like clone. And with DraftSight open, I can open up any existing DWG or DXF data. So I'll go ahead and open and browse right to my webinar folder here. And you'll notice I have a DWG here named part. If we open that up, that's just a simple, very, you know, obviously that we can make this more complicated, but it's a very simple DWG of this kind of a yoke, just, you know, some widget, basically. How can we get this into SolidWorks? How can we leverage this 2D data into SolidWorks? I can make changes here in DraftSight, all the same changes you can make in a 2D program. I can even copy and paste directly from DraftSight into SolidWorks. But just to show you guys really what's going on under the hood, I'm going to defer back to SolidWorks. So I'm going to minimize this. We'll go back to SolidWorks. We'll do a file open. And I can actually browse directly to a DWG file. And there's that same DWG file that we had open. So we'll open this up, and SolidWorks will say at that point, do you want to make a new drawing or do you want to make a new part? I want to make a new part with a 2D sketch. I could even pick if there's a certain layer that I want to bring in. You know, we could turn off the title block or something like that if we wanted to. But we're going to go ahead and hit finish and bring this guy in. So what it does right away is it takes that 2D sketch, that 2D file, and drops it onto a plane in SolidWorks as a sketch. Just like we did before. We sketched a bunch of lines to make that box. This is the same thing. And if you'll notice, it is actually flat. You know, it is a flat 2D sketch. Really all I want to do to start off here is capture this 2D profile, this main one going in this direction. So it's really this view that I need. SolidWorks has a number of great selection tools, so I can literally just pick all those lines and delete them, pick all these lines and delete them, all of those guys as well. And now all that's gone, just with some simple window select tools. We can zoom in, and even here inside, we have just nice things that make working easier in SolidWorks. You know, left to right, we'll get things that fall entirely in that box. Right to left, we'll get anything that touches that box at all. So that works great in this situation. So we'll go ahead, get rid of those guys. And this is another great one. Matt Kelly loves this one. If you've ever done any trimming in MasterCam or in AutoCAD or anything like that, SolidWorks has some really great trimming functions. My favorite, and usually the one you'll use most commonly, is Power Trim. So I can go ahead and just get rid of those tangent lines for those arcs up top that I don't really need at the moment. That looks pretty good. The final thing here is just we want to lock this thing down. We don't want this sketch just floating up in space. I want to do a control all that will control A just picks everything. Move entities. I'll just move this point to this point. And at this point, the sketch is where I want it to be. The origin is in a good place, but nothing is defined. You know, I could just grab this line and move it, and that's not any good. I really want my lines to be locked down. What a lot of people do, you can just control A and say fix, make everything fixed, which is nice. It'll lock it down, but then you lose the ability to change it and modify it. So instead, another great tool is this, fully defined sketch. Fully defined sketch will calculate every dimension needed to lock this sketch down completely. The power of that is now I have the ability to come in and change those if I want to. Maybe these holes, for example, are 30, and we could make them 20 and notice that they both update. Fully defined sketch did realize that they were the same hole, and then we'll put those back to 30. Sketch is locked down. We'll go right to features, extruded boss, and this time we'll do a mid-plane with a total of 60 and pull that guy out. Green check. So that's nice. That's our first main profile. And I still have draft site open. You can kind of see what we did there. What about those arcs though? And what about the holes in the side of the part? How can we capture that? Well, now we can really start to see some of the editing and part creation tools in SolidWorks. The fillet tool, for example. We can do a full round fillet on these three faces, and SolidWorks will go ahead and round that top edge off for me. Green check, and we can do the same thing right on the other side. And it'll take those tops and round them off. I didn't have to cut, make a profile, you know, remove material. SolidWorks will do all of that for you. How about the holes on the side of the part? Just like before, I can pick any flat face and open a new sketch and choose the circle command, and we can even pick up on the center point of that arc and just kind of drag that out and drop it there. And with our dimension tool, we'll lock that hole down to 16. So from here, you know, we do have the ability with this instant 3D function to pick this circle, and I can just pull it into 3D. This is almost like a direct editing function, being able to grab a profile and just pull it into 3D. It is smart enough to notice that if I push it into the material, it will become a cut, and I can even push it all the way through the part. So I have that ability just right here on the fly to be able to create that without having to do, you know, sketch it, go into the feature, create the cut, set my depth. I can do all of this with a simple click and drag. So that's our rough part so far. We might want to do a little bit further, but at this point, always be saving. Always go ahead and save your files. I'm going to go ahead and save now. And maybe right on my, right in this webinar folder, we'll make a new folder called Parts. And we'll go in there and we'll drop this, whatever you guys want to name this. Maybe we'll name this Mr. Kelly, just because Mr. Kelly is just such a nice guy.
Show the man some respect.
He's sitting right here, and he's really helping me out with this webinar, so we'll go ahead and hit save. So now Mr. Kelly is saved into this file, and life's good. That's what it's like to open up a 2D DWG file, bring it in, use it to make a really simple part in SolidWorks. And obviously, the more complicated the DWG is, the more lines and arcs and profiles you can use to cut, to extrude, to do a number of other features in SolidWorks. All right, so how about some other functions? Now that you have the 3D, now that we have the benefit of the 3D file, we can do things like run a cost analysis on it. SolidWorks introduced this costing function, where I can turn on costing. And costing will ask me, all right, what material is this part made from? It's made from, let's start with an aluminum, and we'll just stick with 6061. And it will apply a default material cost. And, of course, you can change this. If it's, you know your supplier is a little bit different, you can certainly change this. You'll also notice that it applied a default stock around the material. You can change this as well. Mr. Kelly brought up the good point that, you know, if you guys are getting stock from a certain supplier who sells it in very specific dimensions, you can certainly input those here, and that's going to be your realistic stock for this part. Other things you can specify are things like the quantity of the parts and the lot size, because that definitely affects the cost of making this. Your shop rate as well can be input into here. All of these functions, all of these numbers add up to give you the cost of making this part. This is driven from the actual setup, the whole operations, the specific, you know, whether it's a pocket or, you know, whether it's drilling a hole. All of these have a specified cost to them, which is driven from this template. Now, the templates that come with costing are pretty good, but the idea here is that your shop has the ability to come in here and specify these per your standards. So you're actually able to really generate a very realistic costing for the parts that you make. Again, the stock ones are pretty good. The out-of-the-box ones are pretty in-depth, but the idea is you really want to come in here and input the values that make sense for your company. You're going to end up with a cost here, and what's nice is this updates real-time. So if we add a fillet, if we, for example, change the material, what if we switch this over to steel? We'll notice that once we switch this over to a plain carbon steel, the cost goes up 45% for making that part from the last one. So that's great. It's just great real-time information that you're getting about this part. The final thing here is really what you want to see, generating a report. Generating a report will take all this data and drop it into a really nice-looking template in Microsoft Word. This is really great for bidding on a project, for completing a project and having it ship out the door with the part, how much it actually costs you to make it. It's great for quoting. It's all these things really, this really lends itself towards a lot of different functions, in the machining world. So now that we have this generated, you can drop your company logo, all your different information. This is just all part of the template that it kicks out. And this report will be generated for you automatically. You don't have to sit there and format this in Word. It'll do it for you. So that's really nice. Again, it's just a nice professional-looking report that can ship out the door, go into a bid for a project or something like that. So that's costing. Mr. Kelly brought up a good point earlier. We could do a whole webinar just on costing because it is a really nice add-in. But just for the sake of time here, we're going to keep moving right along. So what else can we do now that we have the 3D model? How about fixturing? How about, how am I going to make this part? How does it fit within my machine or within the fixtures that I have? A really great thing you can do for fixtures and for stuff like that, I'm sure you guys already know about this, but you can go out to the websites for these different fixture companies and download the files for those fixtures. For example, Matt brought me right to this one, Kurt Workholding Company, and we're able to just specify the vise that we want, and they have their 2D and 3D CAD files right there. There's also other places like grabcad.com, 3dcontentcentral.com is another good one that you can just go ahead and search for, vise, and you'll get a whole bunch of different entries and different things that you can download that other people have modeled and put up on the internet for you to use. The benefit to that is once you have something like that, I have one in my recent history here, you can open up a vise in SolidWorks like this one. I just opened up a different file, and now I'm able to get some movement out of it, see how my part is going to fit within it, see if I'm going to have any issues when I get to the machine, if I have to do any different type of holdings or anything like that. So how about we actually bring that part in here and see how it's going to fit? So if we go right to insert components, Mr. Kelly is already open. Mr. Kelly is there waiting for us to use them. So we can go ahead and choose it, and then you'll notice it actually hooks it to my cursor and I can drop it right in space. So let's make one where the part is standing up and maybe Matt for drilling out this slot or for milling out the slot on the top of the part, right? So I can take this face and choose the mate option. And if I mate those together, we can just say we'll go ahead and make them parallel. And now those faces are kind of, they can be as far apart as they want, but they have to remain parallel. If we just pick this face instead and this one, we can use the coincident, which means that those faces have to remain touching and perfectly lined up like that. Same thing goes for this one and this one. Those will snap into place, and then finally this one and this one. Now those will snap into place. If you'll notice now, it's actually hooked to our vise. So no matter where I put that, the part is going to follow. And of course, we're going to finish up with this one and this one. So now our part is perfectly locked into the vise, and we can do things like, again, I think MasterCam has the ability to bring in these and check for clearances, and you're not going to hit the vise and things like that.
Right. You can set up configurations for each setup. So Dan set this up to be set up one. He'll make an assembly configuration of this, and then he can then rotate the part, put it where it needs to be for setup two, save that up as a configuration. And when you're using your standalone Mastercam, you can read in this file and as a SolidWorks file, and it will give you the option to open a certain configuration at that time. So you could read in, say, setup one configuration, put that on a certain level, do what you need to do. You can open up the second setup as a configuration, read that. If you're using Mastercam for SolidWorks, where Mastercam is actually located in the SolidWorks here, you can use those configurations for your setups also.
So Matt brings up a great point. With this first one, this is our default setup. Maybe I want to rename that to setup one. But in setup two, all those mates we just made don't really make any sense. You know, we can just take these last four here, and we'll just go ahead and suppress them. So now our part is kind of free-floating back in space, and this guy is able to move around again. So in this case, we want to lay this part over to come down from the top and drill the hole. So maybe I'll pick this face and this one and make those into place. Green check on that. And then, of course, this guy to this one, now those are in place. Green check on that one. And on the back side, we could pick that face and that face, green check. So we're kind of right back where we were before, but now the part's in a different orientation. This one and this one just to finish it up. What's nice is I've created a separate configuration. So with these two configurations created, I can just quickly switch back and forth between them. Here's my default or setup one, and then here's my setup two. And as Matt mentioned, when you bring this into Mastercam, you can choose between the two configurations. You can decide which one you want to bring in at that time. And think about how clean it is here to manage it in SolidWorks, because it's all under this one file. You can have as many setups as you want, obviously, as many configurations as you want. Really, you're just turning on and turning off different mates, different rules for how this part is held into place. All right, so we could continue with fixtures, but I think you guys kind of get the idea there. The next thing we want to talk about is making drawings of this part for communication. How do we document how big the part is, what it looks like, what the holes are, and how do we communicate that to customers, to partners, to vendors, to anybody. So if we go back to the part that we made, and we'll just turn off costing just so we don't have to see the stock piece there anymore, I can say make drawing from part. And this is really simple. If any of you guys have ever made drawings in AutoCAD, this is usually the moment where you fall out of your chair because of how fast this is. So we'll go ahead and drag in the front view, the side view. We'll get the top up here, and if I hold control, we'll get our isometric up here off to the side. And we can even take that ISO and make it like shaded with edges just to give a nicer feel. Drawings, again, could be a whole webinar in itself, a whole class, in fact, in itself. But we'll just do a couple quick section views here, drop that off to the side, and then maybe a nice detail view of this point. And we'll pull that up. And what's nice is the section does resize. If you want to take that and resize it, you see the detail updates real time. Now, that might be a little bit laggy on the webinar, but you can kind of see what we're doing there. In terms of dimensions, it's easy just to then go ahead and start dimensioning things. I can grab any dimension off this part and annotate it here with a simple click of a button, just like we were doing in the sketch. You can even use model items to bring all the dimensions in from the part, so you don't have to redo them here. That's simple and that's easy to do. But now that we've created this, maybe there's some further information you need about these holes. Is it tapped? Is it a tight fit, or what is the hole, and maybe the customer didn't supply you with enough information. So we can go ahead and save this drawing. I'll say save as, and we can save it as what we call an e-drawing. An e-drawing on my desktop here, if we go right to the webinar folder, if we save this as mrkelly.edrw, it's an e-drawings file, and we'll go ahead and hit save. eDrawings is another free product. I mentioned DraftSight earlier, but eDrawings is another free product from SolidWorks. So if I just go to my programs here, we find SolidWorks, you'll notice that we have SolidWorks eDrawings, which is a free viewer anybody can download from SolidWorks.com. And a lot of you might have already downloaded it just because it is a really great viewer. I can open that file directly right from my desktop. We'll find that webinar folder, wherever I'm hiding it. There it is. And there's that Mr. Kelly EDRW, and we'll go ahead and open that up. What's nice about this is eDrawings gives you the ability to mark up. So maybe I'll make a nice zoomed in. We have a lot of great tools here, but for example, the balloon here, and we'll say, you know, is this tapped?
Or defined.
Or defined hole. So whatever you want, and Matt will make fun of me because I'm not a machinist, and I'll say something that doesn't make sense. But is this a tapped hole, right? Is it tapped? Or maybe you could further define this, or you know, maybe we'll go to this edge over here and apply another one right in this corner, and say, you know, should we use a fillet or a round or you know whatever you want to call it? Question mark for grammatically correct there. And we'll just keep that off to the side. What's nice is this will save into this file. These markups will save directly into that eDrawing file. And now you have the ability just to send this to your customer, to go ahead and send this file directly to them. eDrawings is a free viewer. They can open it and download it. And they can see these markups. And they click them and actually takes them right to that area on the drawing. They can run through these. They can easily make decisions, get back to you, and let you know what you need to do for this part in SolidWorks or in MasterCAM. So eDrawings is a really great communication tool that allows you to collaborate with your customers, vendors, partners, whoever it is. You can get it directly from SolidWorks.com. So one final thing here for collaboration and communication, how about multiple file formats? How about communications with different types of files? We get back to this file here. I'm sure a lot of you guys machine to STEP, IGIS, maybe PowerSolid, depending on what the application here is. But just so there's no smoke and mirrors, I'm going to go ahead and save this part directly as we'll do a STEP. Right, Mr. Kelly? We'll go ahead and do a STEP. So we'll hit save as, and we'll save as copy it. That option doesn't matter for this moment. And we'll choose a STEP. And right in this parts folder, that's fine. So it's going to be MrKelly.step. So if, at this point, if I do a window close all, again, no smoke and mirrors, we're going to get rid of everything. I'm going to close everything in SolidWorks. I can go ahead, hit open, and there's that MrKelly.step. And I can even just say, you know what, I only want to see.
Yeah, if you stay there for a second, Dan.
Sure.
This was the part where we have all the native translators. So we realized that, for example, some of these, and you can see it's a lot of different file formats that can be open and written out of SolidWorks. You saw the DXF, DWG, you have those kind of intermediate type formats with PowerSolid, IGIS, STEP, ASUS, VDAs in there as well. But then you also have the native formats. And I know that if you're a Pro E or you're a MasterCAM user, you want the Pro E, the ability to read in Pro E files directly, it's 2000. Same thing for Unigraphics, Mr. Kelly?
Yes.
So, I mean, if you need two of those translators, it's $4,000. It's more or equal to what SolidWorks costs. So we realize that just for the file translation capabilities alone, and we also know that sometimes you get strong-armed, hey, if you can't read the file, then you can't quote it. Oh, well, move on. And so we know how sometimes what your challenges are that you face. But if you look at the native formats, the Pro E, the Unigraphics, Inventor, Solid Edge, even CADKey, we can read Rhino files directly as well. There's a lot of value typically here. So you can have that better communication collaboration with your customer, your partners. So beyond, I know you're going after this step, so I'll let you go back to that.
Thank you, sir.
But this would be the example, I think, where you're going is you've got an intermediate format, some universal type format. How do you quote this? Okay, what can you do once it comes into SolidWorks?
Absolutely. So with the step created, you know, again, you guys might have got this from a customer, partner, vendor, website, you know, who knows. I can go ahead and open it directly in SolidWorks. It right away notices it's important and says, hey, do you want to run diagnostics? Make sure the part is sound. Make sure it's okay. We hit yes. It does actually find a faulty face on the back, some maybe a little tiny hole somewhere. We'll go ahead and tell it to heal all, and it does. Nope, no problem. Patches everything up. And it asks me if I want to proceed with feature recognition. And I'm going to hit no because I'm going to show you kind of a different route to get there. And we'll turn on edges just so you guys can see. So the part will come in just kind of a, we call it a dumb solid, an imported blob. That doesn't mean it's useless to us, though. We can pick this hole and actually say, let's edit the feature for that hole. Even though that hole's not actually a SolidWorks hole, let's edit feature. And SolidWorks will actually recognize that, okay, it was actually a 16-millimeter hole. It was through wall. It was this far. Now we have the ability to edit that feature, and we can change it to whatever we want. We can even add additional holes if we want more of those at this point. That's entirely up to us. The fact is that SolidWorks is actually recognizing that hole as now a SolidWorks feature. You can do the same for these holes. You can even run the overall diagnostics tool to try and get the hole mass out of it. But the point here is, even though it's a dumb solid, even though you got it from a customer, doesn't mean it's useless to you. What if you need to add a couple rounds or, you know, round off a couple sharp corners, maybe interior corners or something like that? You can use the fillet tool directly on an imported part. It doesn't matter. It still means you can round those corners off, green check those. Maybe I'll turn the fillet tool back on and we'll make those smaller and do these upper edges here. We can even pick through different groups. It's noticing different groups of edges all over the part. That group of edges there, for example. Just some really nice things that, even though it's an imported step file, doesn't mean it's useless to us. We can still use it, manipulate it, and change it. So that pretty much wraps up the main topics I wanted to cover, unless you guys have anything else.
I just got to add to that. You already saw it with the drawings, but when Dan, if your dilemma is you got a step file, you have to quote it. You could certainly interact with the file a little bit more, but you can make those three views that came from a step file that was just sent to you and said, hey, can you quote this part?
Yeah.
And we could drag and drop, regardless whether it's something we created or whether you just read the file. And you can literally open up something, lay out your few views, and put some overall dimensions on it, and get an understanding what that part is and what you're missing.
Yep.
So
really doesn't matter if this was imported. We can still make your drawing and still do all the same functions we can do, even though that it was an imported part.
So that can help out with quoting and just being the ability to quote, ability to make drawings. Then obviously you saw some of the other capability with fixturing.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we're out on the road. We're in a lot of shops, and the big question is, okay, I get this solid model, and it has holes in it. We don't know what they are. How do we communicate that to our customer? And I felt that this was a great tool, using the e-drawings to define the holes, whether they're tapped or reamed. It could definitely put a price difference in your quote, depending on how accurate those holes have to be. So we just thought this would be a good way just to show you guys how this works.
All right, everybody. So that pretty much wraps up the content we had. Chris, I don't know if you have any closing remarks.
That was basically it. We just wanted to let's bring that up here. How do I get there? All right. Yeah, we want to thank you for your time. And then that's our contact information.
Yeah, it's covered up.
No.
No, it is. Yeah. So if there are questions, please feel free to just type them in. We'll try to address them as a group. If you'd like to talk to us individually, that's fine. You have our contact information up here. And certainly there are some incentives. Again, we worked out with SolidWorks. If you saw something that was compelling here, that makes sense for your business, that you want to talk about further, we're happy to do so.
All right. That's pretty much it, everybody. Thank you very much for your time. If anything else comes up, please follow up with us.